This is a lecture on Sheehan syndrome. The learning objectives are as follows. To understand the definition and pathophysiology of Sheehan syndrome, to identify the causes and clinical features of Sheehan syndrome, and finally, to order investigations and manage Sheehan syndrome. In 1937, Sheehan first published a report describing pituitary necrosis at the time of autopsy in women who died from obstetric hemorrhage. Subsequently, in 1965, he estimated the prevalence of the syndrome to be 100 to 200 per 1 million women. However, due to improvements in obstetrical care over the years, the number of women surviving profound postpartum hemorrhage has increased. Hence, the frequency of Sheehan syndrome has also decreased substantially, especially in developed countries. For instance, in 2010, a nationwide retrospective population-based study in Iceland estimates the prevalence to be 5.1 in 100,000 women. However, these findings are not representative of the situation worldwide. An epidemiologic study conducted in Kashmir Valley, India in 2005 showed that the projected number of women with Sheehan syndrome would be approximately 3% of the total population of Paris females greater than 20 years old. As such, the different levels of obstetric care could be the main reason underlying different prevalences across countries. The pathogenesis of Sheehan syndrome is not totally certain, although there is no doubt that the basic process is infarction secondary to the arrest of blood flow to the anterior lobe of the pituitary gland. Towards the end of pregnancy, the pituitary gland is significantly enlarged, mainly from hyperplasia of prolactin-secreting cells. An overall increase of 136% in the volume of pituitary gland on MRI when compared with that of the control group was reported. However, the blood supply to the anterior pituitary remained the same, which is that from the superior hypophyseal artery, a low-pressure portal system which would make it a watershed area. If sudden hemodynamic changes during delivery should occur due to severe hypotension or shock after postpartum bleeding, the anterior pituitary can be susceptible to ischemic necrosis. Other postulated pathogenesis of Sheehan syndrome by leading to tissue infarction include 1. Pituitary enlargement, which may result in the compression of the superior hypophyseal artery and thereby causing a mild ischemia. 2. Arterial vasospasm that may happen after sudden change in arterial pressure during massive bleeding. However, the presence or absence of vasospasm is difficult to assess by microscopic investigation. 3. Thrombosis is a strong possibility, be it caused by platelet aggregation or sequestration along previously damaged endothelial cells. It has been suggested that disseminated intravascular coagulation that develops in a pregnant woman might produce ischemia or hemorrhage in the pituitary gland, leading to its hypofunction. The spectrum of clinical presentations of Sheehan syndrome is very large. A small percentage of patients with Sheehan syndrome may present with abrupt onset of pituitary necrosis immediately after delivery. However, most patients may only manifest the disease 1 to 33 years postpartum. Hormone deficiency also ranges from the loss of a single trophic hormone to classic panhypopituitarism. Growth hormone and TSH deficiency are found most commonly in patients with Sheehan syndrome. They are responsible for the constitutional symptoms of feeling unwell, tired, and weak. Failure of postpartum lactation and secondary amenorrhea are also very common findings, but not absolute requirements to diagnose Sheehan syndrome. Adrenal cortical insufficiency is one of the most important outcomes of Sheehan syndrome. It may result in an adrenal crisis, particularly when the patient is under a stressful condition, such as infection or surgery. Although atrophy of the posterior lobe of the pituitary and hypothalamic nuclei was found in over 90% of the patients with Sheehan syndrome, diabetes insipidus is very rare in this condition. On top of the characteristic history taken from the patient, tests are performed to support a diagnosis of Sheehan syndrome. Partial hypopituitarism or panhypopituitarism is revealed with low levels of pituitary hormones, such as FSH, LH, ACTH, as well as target hormones like cortisol and estradiol. Additionally, patients with hypothyroidism caused by hypopituitarism have low free T3 and T4 levels and a reduced or inappropriately normal level of TSH. For definitive diagnosis of ACTH deficiency, especially in the acute phase, insulin tolerance test is required. This test induces transient hypoglycemia, in which a normal pituitary gland stimulates ACTH production and cortisol release. In a patient with Sheehan syndrome, both ACTH and cortisol levels will remain low. Also, imaging with MRI or CT scanning is indicated at any stage to exclude mass lesions. However, at an acute phase, the pituitary gland appears enlarged and non-hemorrhagic, which is not helpful and not used frequently in acute diagnosis of Sheehan syndrome. It is only diagnostic at a later stage when the pituitary gland undergoes atrophy and involution, revealing an empty cella with only CSF. Sheehan syndrome is a problem of pituitary insufficiency. Thus, the main aim of treatment is to replace the deficient hormones. This is important not only to correct the endocrine imbalances, but also to reduce morbidity and mortality of hypopituitarism. As ACTH deficiency will lead to adrenal crisis, the most urgent treatment for a patient with severe hypopituitarism and fluid depletion is to administer glucocorticoids such as cortisol and prednisone. Hypothyroidism is treated with levothyroxine. However, as this drug can precipitate an acute adrenal crisis, it is important to start treatment with glucocorticoids prior to administration. Estrogen alone is given if a woman has had a hysterectomy. If not, a combination of estrogen and progesterone is given. For patients who are treated with this option, future pregnancies may be possible with an injection of gonadotropins to induce ovulation. Growth hormone replacement is controversial in a grown woman and standard recommendations are currently not available. It is only decided by the physician on a case-by-case basis and should only be considered after all other deficient hormones are replaced. We have now come to the end of our presentation of Sheehan syndrome after covering its epidemiology, pathophysiology, clinical presentation, investigations, and management. You may find our references behind. Thank you for your kind attention.